right. Welcome to the show, everybody.
What's happening?
DutchCast from the road. I'd like Hopefully to welcome Mr. Ahead. Jon Blaze to the DutchCast. Finally. Long overdue.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here. The finally comment caught me off guard. I thought I was, you know,
pretty early.
You are. This is the lead episode. Seven. Well, honored to be amongst those men and women. You're in the top 10. That's awesome.
Nice.
What sort of format do you guys follow for your DutchCast? I don't really know.
Freestyle. Oh, you haven't even listened to it, dude.
I came in. You know,
I sent them to him, but
it's not that I haven't seen some clips. It's that I haven't, by design, wanted to create any biases or influences. I wanted to come in eyes wide open on the format.
We appreciate it.
Usually would have a single that started in episode one.
Yep. Always have a single right here.
Yep, single for it. So I have my Heineken Robert Parrish double zeros.
So he's got double zeros, and I got water up driving, but we are driving to you, brother. We are 900 miles away. Tennessee to Shrewsbury.
Yep, I know it well.
Yeah, you do.
But you guys are going to go the back route, you said, right?
Yeah, we're going to stay west of the coast. So we're going to head up 81 all the way through the, you know, on the side of the Appalachian, and then hit up a couple small towns. We'll let Normie get a couple frisbee tosses here in the fields somewhere. And then Cullen Burke said we should check out Gettysburg. So I did Bonner listen and watch a bulk of the Cullen Burke episode, which one, haven't seen or heard from Cullen Burke since Gleason Road days, which is a long time ago. And two, what a military and history vocabulary on that guy. Holy cow.
Incredible. Yeah.
He definitely taught me some things that I was completely unaware of. And, you know, it got me thinking about subject matter or passion areas that we all have. But, you know, for instance, you and your music, you certainly dive that deep. But damn, Cullen, he knew fucking years on releases of fucking tanks and how many horses died in World War One.
Yeah, he knows.
He was off by a few million, but I mean, still impressive.
But he knows the dates, he knows the battlegrounds, he knows I mean, I know a couple of horses there. He battles every battle. Hello?
Hello?
You can hear me okay. We're kind of up in country road right now, but we're gonna get on the highway here in a minute. Should be all right. But John was saying Jack Burke, who is now a stand-up comedian. That makes sense. Perfect sense. I think he lives in Massachusetts still. But he was like the run of the group because he was a couple of years younger. I mean, he hung out with Julie.
Yeah,
they were runs. Yeah, they were runs. So they always like weren't wearing the appropriate amount of clothing.
Now.
No shoes, no shirt. No, either one shoe or no shoes. Usually no shirt.
One
Very
shoe.
Very dirty. Dirt on the face, dirt on the hands. Definitely dirty kids.
Salt
so
of the earth.
The girl. Maddie. Yeah, they were. So, but I don't remember when he threw a rock in our car. Which car did he throw it at? Because I love those old cars. I think it might have been the red Chevy Nova.
Nice.
Man, maybe it was the caravan. So, Bon, I don't know if you knew this. This is fun factoid, but the Chevy Nova did very, very poorly in Spanish-speaking countries because Nova is Spanish for "does not go." Nova, and they determined that they weren't going to sell in Spanish-speaking countries anymore because the Chevy Nova, which is very popular here in the States and elsewhere.
But our dad lived in that car.
What year was the Nova?
A couple nights. Well, yeah. No, Peter makes a good point. Maybe it's a good segue.
What year is the Nova?
I would say it was probably like an 80, An 88.
It's an 86.
86.
It's a 96.
It's a 96.
It's my brand new car.
It's a 96.
My aunt had a 83 Nova, and it was gold with the tan interior.
Oh.
The fucking ashtrays all around, dude. Awesome.
Oh, everyone needs at least two ashtrays. Like, in the, you can't just have one. You need two.
Dude, I was watching something about old Cadillacs where the ashtray actually had, like, a compartment that you could stack cigarettes in, and there's a little button underneath that dispenses the cigarette out for you, dude. Like, hardcore luxury automobile.
Yeah, I mean, it was the golden age of people wanting to think they're better than they are in terms of, like, luxury. Like, Kev, our dad, who's the opposite of luxury, I don't know what that is, but he's that. He had a zip-up car phone in the Mercedes-Benz diesel he had. You know? Like, Dad, what do you need that for, dude? You're 840.
You guys going east or west on 40?
Yeah, you could turn around. I could turn around, yeah.
I think I'm going to turn around. Okay, we're going to turn around. But, sorry, go ahead, brother.
Are you guys going east or west on 40? Probably west, right?
We're going east on 24.
24 to 81.
So we got to go 40. We got to get off here and go back. I never really go 40.
Anyway, I want this to be a highly rated Dutch cast compared to those other Jababas. So let's, you know, cover some content here. Let's please the subscribers, the readership.
I'm down. You know? I'm down. Well, we come from a very distinct subculture. I think we should establish that you know, we grew up in a suburb outside of Worcester, which is outside of Boston, called Shrewsbury, Massachusetts, and that's where we made a name for ourselves and count our blessings.
How did you get to Shrewsbury, Bonner?
Or should we ask? Well, I was born in Framingham, and that's where my mother was living at the time. And once she got together with my stepdad, Dave, he had grown up in Shrewsbury as a kid. So when they wanted to, like, get a place together, that was, like, at the top of the list, buying a house in Shrewsbury. And the first house we bought was actually a lot closer to you guys. It was on Harrington Ave, 101 Harrington Ave, Shrewsbury.
101 Harrington.
Wow. Know it well. I feel like Joe's and Drosny lived on that for a little while. Joe's Drosny. You lived, there was a little dead end street, right?
Wait, where we used to party? Yeah, I actually lived on that dead end street, but my address was Harrington. But I was on that little dirt road. Marshall Erickson also lived there. Fucking Ryan Vartanian. A couple other people were on that, like, strip. Sarah Lucier.
I can't even see this. Okay, so, yeah, I remember that house. It was near, you know, Steve Elworthy's, right? In Old Mill.
Yeah.
Never been there, but remember watching the videos of you with the WrestleMania dolls going nuts in the basement of that place.
Wrestle Buddies?
No.
With the arms?
Yeah, wrestling buddies, dude. With the arms.
Yeah, dude. Those guys were great.
I had the Legion of Doom. I had the fucking tag team there. The Legion of Doom.
Talking Animal.
Talking Animal. Yep.
Bushwhackers.
Bushwhackers.
I mean, wrestling to me is, for some reason, we didn't watch it avidly, but, like, all of us were aware of the top dogs, the Undertakers of the world, the Bret and Owen Harts.
Hey, Brian Terrill.
What's that, dude?
Coming in with the quality audio, too. Nice.
I got the gamer headset, baby.
Yeah, good shit, man. Appreciate it.
That Tennessee life stuff.
Nice.
Hey, BT, I was just mentioning Wrestling Buddies, and Down Bonner was. He was talking about the Legion of Doom. Which Wrestle Buddies did the Terrell House have? I'm picturing a Hogan.
Hogan, probably.
Hogan and Macho Man.
That's right. The two class. Well, they were the classics.
The Ultimate Warrior was another big one that a lot of kids had.
Mm-hmm. You
know? Never. Little did those kids know they were idolizing a heroin, cocaine, steroid. Is he on
the stuff? He's a pretty good motivational speaker.
BT, I heard the Celtics were getting beat up tonight.
Oh yeah, dude. They were. Yeah. No, and that's why I didn't hop on until now. They were just making a good comeback in the very end, and then fell apart. So I think we ended up losing by like six, but we were down 30 for a long time.
Well, they need to hit a soft spot this season. They're not going to be, they're not going to be the 96 goals. Like, let's lose some games, get it out of the system.
This is a rough patch, though. This is tough to watch.
What, your life or the Celtics?
Both. And just seeing you on camera sucks.
Norman's here, BT.
Who is?
Norman's in the back.
Oh, yeah, hiding?
Norman. Yeah, he's kind of sleeping. Norman! What's up, buddy?
Norman, come on out of the street. He's sleeping.
No, well, it's a good dog to sleep in the car. All my dog does is whine like a little bitch.
Well, some say their dogs imitate their owners, so maybe there's something to be said there.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe I'm just, like, complaining too much about the traffic and shit the whole time I'm going down the road.
Well, going down the road feeling bad, dude.
Going down the road, yep.
That's right. So this podcast really doesn't have a time limit on it because we got 17 hours. So,
oh, okay.
All nighter, baby.
So after you guys leave, Peter and I will just pretend we're on the cast, and it might get really weird. Actually, sleep down.
No, man, we'll keep it going. It'll be like the first 4-hour episode.
It'll be like the first. What's his name that makes those long-ass documentaries? Jazz, baseball.
Ken Burns, baby.
This will be the Ken Burns.
Well, you got Cody in California, so in a couple hours you can hop on with him easily.
Oh, yeah.
It was great to see Cody. Great to see Cody, by the way. And I thought out of all of you, he looked the healthiest. Yes. His skin was good. His hair was good. He had good posture, everything. The rest of us looks like a bunch of ragabonds.
Yeah, totally. I agree with you. Yeah, Cody looked good. He's got the...
Dennis looks good.
He's got the height. Yeah.
But then you got Steve. You can't clean up Steve. You can't clean up BT.
Never.
You can barely clean up this guy.
Yeah, my fucking whole tuxedo was just mis-sized.
No, you look good, Bonner.
Yeah.
It's nice to meet your lady. I hope she was Jon Blaze supportive.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, she dug you a lot, man. And it was great having you there, fucking having some, some Dutch masters. You know, I consider you guys both Dutches, too, you know?
I mean, look, I it's kind of like the extended... Wu-Tang Clan. Like, in no way am I in the Dutch Masters, but I'm...
Yeah, you're like you're like the Belladonna or the fucking, someone like that.
That's right.
He's the Red Man.
The Red Man, yep.
I'll take Red Man all day. That's
I know. No, I don't want to give you that. That's too good. Do you see what this is, by the way?
What do you got?
October?
Sam October. I found Turnpike Liquors is still selling them somehow. I was like, all right, do them all.
They finished selling them in September, just like they finished selling Sam Summers in July. It's like, what are you guys doing?
That's true.
Yeah,
it's true.
Mm-hmm. No, you're right.
It's had time to age more in the bottle, so it's got a more distinctive flavor.
That's right. I'm 4 weeks alcohol free, and these are 00 Heineken. So
cheers to that.
Those taste good, actually, dude. I actually like those.
Yeah, no, I've been I wanted to dry out a little bit, but also with the four nights of Phish coming up, I wanted to be in peak health and enjoy it. So
yeah, there you go. Good. That's gonna be a blast, man. You're going to every single one, John?
Yeah, I got all four nights. Yeah.
Psycho. Wow.
Where are you staying out there? Are you staying with the family or?
No, you can't. No, I'll be on drugs for 4 days. There's no need for family.
Staying under a staircase somewhere.
Him and
I got a luxury hotel for myself for 6 days. I have a friend, and it's 2 blocks from the garden. I've got my friend who I went to my first Phish tour with in 04, Mike DeFrisco, is coming the first night.
Nice.
He's an old friend.
Do I know him?
None of you know him. He's a Phish friend. None of you know
the Phish fam.
So
Pete, you don't know him.
Peter James Edwards is coming to his first Phish show on the second night.
Yep.
Nice.
Looking forward to that.
And then
Kev will be there.
Old Faithful. Kev is coming 2 nights.
KE is going to the Phish show?
What's that?
KE is coming? No.
Kev Stan. Oh, man. Oh, jeez.
My dad would die. My dad would die even walking into Madison Square Garden. Never mind going to the Phish show. But, yeah, so Kev and I, you know, Kev goes to a lot of same shows as I do, but Lowe gave him the go-ahead. Because, look, I put in for the lottery. You get what you get. And I got all 4 nights, so, you know, you gotta do it. Of course, that's what I want to do, but to get people to sack up and get to New York City.
Well, what do you mean? Where is my invite? I feel like my phone... What's up?
You're not a Phish guy.
Oh, come on. I've probably seen Phish 10 times. That's a Phish guy right there. 6.5 hours getting into Coventry.
Have you gone to see Phish, Bri?
No, Bri, you haven't seen Phish, Bri.
I definitely have seen you Phish have? 10 times. Oh, definitely. When they finally came back and their first show was at Fenway after their hiatus, was there at that show with Kevo Foley.
I was there.
I doubt it.
No, I was definitely there. That was the day that they played Cool Stop the Rain, I believe, and during the it was raining, it was pouring, and then the sun came out. It was a pretty epic show. You can look it up online, and it's pretty well known for that. But yeah, sure, dude. You want to come?
Wow. Oh, I mean, at this point, I've already made plans, so.
Good. I didn't invite you in the first place. I also have Mexico tickets, but I think I'm going to pass on those. I think 8 shows a year as a 38-year-old man is plenty versus 12.
Old.
That's not too bad. But, yeah, that's not too bad.
No, I did 2 nights Mansfield, 2 nights Jones Beach, 4 nights MSG.
You're like the high end of the chain there. Fucking just getting in the good ones, you know.
You got to be intentional with your time, Bonner, right? In life, it's very fleeting.
Did I tell you about how
intentional with your time?
how Trevor? Do you know about Trevor and how he knows Mike Gordon and shit through the restaurant and?
Yeah. He was telling me that Gordo comes in all the time.
Yeah,
because they're like, awesome. Aren't they like crunchy vegans together or something like that?
I think Mike Gordon is a vegan, or he eats mostly vegan, and I think that's why he likes to eat there. But
I think he's taking drum lessons from Trev. I'm pretty sure.
Trevor looked great, by the way.
Yeah. All the vegan California people look awesome.
All of them vegan.
And all us East Coasters are all beat up.
That's right. We're all a bunch of ragabonds. We're like a biker gang. You're just fucking deteriorating by the minute.
Some leather jackets would have been good for that wedding for sure.
I like the venue too. I just thought it was a great weekend. You guys threw a good party.
Pistol, yeah. How many hours are you in so far? I'm late to the podcast. Like 20
first
minutes.
Hour. And it's 9 minutes. And we took a wrong turn. So
yeah,
we're probably
going down away and never gone. But we're 17 miles in. And
nice.
I didn't even think about
it. We'll be in at midnight tomorrow. So we've got tomorrow. We're gonna go to Gettysburg actually.
Nice.
Gonna go see.
Oh man, you guys should get there for like sunrise.
It's the goal. We can't. Sunset. We'll be there by sunset tomorrow. That's not true, brother.
Yes, it is. I mapped it out.
dude, it's 9 p.m.
Yeah.
By 9 a.m., we're going to be 12 hours into the drive. The drive is 15 hours. Where does this sunset?
So do it, yeah. We can plan to be there for sunrise. That'll be sick.
Yeah, see the mist and the dew, the morning dew.
Yeah, and, dude.
And like Denzel Washington will be there for some reason.
Yeah.
Matthew Broderick. Or Matthew Broderick. Man. Matthew Broderick is the best guy, I don't think. What's the best movie Matthew Broderick has been in? Okay. Let's
clearly.
Well, I mean, that's his most iconic role
guy,
for sure.
Cable guy.
Cable guy. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Cable guy.
Do you remember an early '80s movie called War Games?
Yes,
I think.
No. Yes.
Where he's like a computer hacker and he hacks into like the government's attacks on like another country or some shit, and they're like after him and. And there was another one that he's been in around the same time as Ferris called Project X, where he's an animal rights guy and he helps bust out these chimpanzees from like an animal prison. That's an old school Broderick one, dude.
Dude, I don't know that.
That is VHS.
I do remember going to Alan Pandiani's 13th birthday party to see Godzilla at Showcase North.
Starring
Broderick.
Yep.
Still married to what's her name? That long
was this with Pandiani. Now he always wanted to be a Dutch master. I feel, but he really didn't have he really didn't have an angle.
He had his own angle. Yeah, he's part of the Wu-Tang Clan.
He's part of the Wu-Tang Clan for sure. But yeah, he never was a Dutch.
He's part of the Wu-Tang Clan.
I feel more Dutch than him.
You totally are, John. The problem with Al was that he couldn't write his own lyrics. He could only recite NWA's word for word, like, perfectly.
Yeah. Hey, at least he chose wisely
and caught it off as his own,
right? Yeah.
That's funny.
He's in the queue. Pandiani's in the queue as a guest, for sure.
So who have the guests been so far? I'd love to hear the rundown.
Mainly just me. It's just been me.
Bri's been on twice. We had Rodney Norman, I think the second or third episode. He's a big guy on Instagram. We had Kim back on. We had Cullen on. We did a couple, I think, just me and Pete. So this is like the 9th one, I think. So not that many so far. Not that many guests.
I got half the comeback one so far. It's solid.
Yeah.
You know, he's still one of the best ball handlers I've seen as a youngster.
Yeah. That's what I was saying, yeah.
The kid's got handle. I mean,
10 minutes remaining.
He's a tremendous athlete. He's just like a hobby. Yeah. He's not big enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's way more athletic than I am, than you are, than any of us.
Oh, yeah. He was hand-eye, he had handle.
But he just couldn't kick it fast.
Yeah, he could handle really well. He could be a really good point guard. I thought he was a great point guard, but yeah.
Great point guard. And Shane could shoot the lights out. I remember that team.
Yeah, Shane and Frankie Vaccaro in the fucking paint, dude.
heavy feats, Frankie. I saw Frankie and Matt a few months ago, all dressed in the nines, at some conference.
Nice.
What Lowe's Worcester thing?
Yeah, Lowe's thing, and they also work with my dear good friend Nick DeSantis. They own the company that Nick works for. Nick's D-Rag's cousin.
Oh, I think I know Nick DeSantis. He used to be in a band, right?
He's a good musician. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah,
yeah, he's a very, very dear friend of mine.
Nice. Oh, I didn't know that.
I golf with him like 20 times a year. Yeah, text with him.
Is he still doing music and shit?
He's got he plays his bass and he's got a set of keys set up, but he's got 3 kids, so life's pretty busy. He's a little, it's funny. He'd actually be a good guest in that he's very contrarian. you know, similar to BT, you know, was always going to say no to whatever you say. But very opinionated on music, in terms of, like, he knows I love music and appreciate music, but we have very few overlapping tastes.
Yeah.
And if I'm, he's like, dude, the Dead is, he thinks the Dead's the worst band of all time. He's like, dude, that's like this most simple, basic, shitty music.
Yeah.
But then he loves, like, he's into metal. He's into some music I think sounds like shit. So, you know, it's an interesting concept that, like, to me, music is always like, it's like food.
I know.
It's like whatever. Like, if you like fucking Indian food, that's your fucking thing. If you like Chinese food, if you like American food, if you like Italian food, whatever. It's just whatever suits you. So I don't hate on anyone's food the same way I don't hate on anyone's music. He loves to hate on music.
Okay. Well, yeah. It's an objective thing, and I agree with you there. Like, I don't ever try to create any conflict out of pure what is pure taste for everybody, you know. I'd rather be able to just talk about it and learn from each other, you know, about different things.
Well, and I think what I'm excited to bring Peter to Phish for is, like, one of the reasons I love and have always loved Phish is it brings you that feeling of what music can do to you as a person. I think there's that feeling in every kind of music, every genre. Mm-hmm. I just, like, I was just walking around Nashville, hit up the Patsy Cline Museum. Instead of Johnny Cash, got some Patsy Cline in me.
Nice.
You know, and you learn about how these foreign musics, to me, maybe they, you know, give the same feeling I get when, you know, I'm peeking on mushrooms and Trey's ripping an ocelot, you know? Maybe mm-hmm. that's the same feeling.
Yeah.
And it is. All right, not to get too woo-woo, but Bonner, you were saying the other day about AI making music now. What's that about?
No. I was responding to a post someone made about, have you guys been hearing about this AI art shit?
Yeah. Just from that post, but yeah.
Well, you know, there's a couple of open source platforms that are offering subscriptions to basically join a peer-to-peer network where you can literally, like, type in characters of, you know, an image that you want to see, and this software will go out into the internet freaking outskirts and basically grab elements from other people's art and forge a artificial intelligence art piece. And it'll render you an image that you can use.
So wait, they're overlaying, like, multiple images to create a new painting, or they're
they're taking in like hundreds of thousands of images at one time, John, based on the terms that you type in.
So if you type in, like, surfing the Pacific, it will, like, come up with a million paintings that have surfers on the Pacific and kind of render something. Now, is the unique,
exactly,
but still
exactly
stolen. Is the AI aiming at doing something unique or something optimal?
It's always unique, Pete. You could put in the same terms 50 times in one day and it'll give you a whole new render every time.
We're not far away from a world that, you know, they're like virtual artists in the musical world that will be normalized. So, like, there'll be holograms of non-existing people who are algorithmically determined based on the tastes of kids' likes on Instagram.
Oh, I'm sure.
Creating.
Yeah.
And they'll make songs that, you know, like, the AI will know, it will be able to predict how many records you sell based on the song they create.
Yeah.
So it's stuff like that. It's never going to, in my opinion, it's never going to replace real art or music.
It'll replace it, but it will replace their jobs. Because if I'm a company looking for a graphic designer, I'm sure there's a easier way to get my art through this tool versus using somebody. And this is how people are going to start to get trouble.
painting on a canvas and taking a nice high definition picture of it and uploading it that way. It's all just like you can be lazy now and just put a couple terms in, put your name on it, and fucking these people who created the art to begin with that's being used for this render are like, what the fuck, man? Is this, you know?
Yeah, but if it's rendering an image from thousands or tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of pieces of art, how would you even be able to tell that your art is a part of that art? Because unless it's stealing like an individual painting and throwing like one more thing on it, they're not gonna recognize it.
John and I were just laughing about that Family Guy episode where Stewie and Brian have a radio show, and he's talking about how we're gonna start to continue to evolve to become a radio show where we have all those different sound things like Dingo in the baby. Like all the slapstick.
Okay, yeah, I think I remember that one.
It's like fart noise.
Well, Brian's my favorite, dude, for sure.
Yeah, Brian. I like Stewie. Yeah, Stewie's great. The gay Stewie. Stewie's great.
I like the Adam West character, too, kind of.
Yeah, no, Mayor West is fantastic. Quagmire, I mean, it's a great show. It's a very violent show.
I know, and they ripped off The Simpsons so much, man.
Arguably.
Definitely the same format.
Well, sure, but John's a big Simpsons guy. Still is, always has been.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very smart show. They basically predict the future all the time. They predicted Trump's presidency. They predicted... They know shit. Mm-hmm. They predicted, like, Elon Musk's, you know, nonsense. Not predicted, but, like, yeah. South Park, as probably the most notable example, gets away with what it does. It's because it's a cartoon. If those were people saying the things that they said about people, it would not be on TV.
No. Yeah, I think you're right about that.
I mean, I saw an interview with them. Was it Trey? What's the...
Trey and Matt.
I went to Team America, that's why. It's hilarious. But they said that they... To get the content they wanted to get out, that's why they go so low budget on the animation, because they actually weren't even reviewing the script with the producers until, like, say the show comes out on Thursday, and they review it on, like, Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
So they couldn't rewrite a show. Because if you know South Park, which I don't, I'm not a fan of it, the show, but I know they're very relevant in terms of, you know, like, timely comedy. So, like, if something happened this week, next week on South Park, they could hit it. Mm-hmm. So that was part of the shtick. But again, they were allowed to get away with more because, one, of that strategy, but two, it's a cartoon. I'm telling you. Cartoons, you can say way worse shit.
Yeah, and believe me, dude, I've wanted to make my own cartoon for a long time, dude.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah, for sure, dude. Imagine the funny shit we could make up for a cartoon, dude. Be hilarious.
We definitely did some stuff with the action figures, I remember.
Oh, the
tell us more about when you're daydreaming about being a cartoon guy. What did you envision in terms of the cartoon?
I think a totally exaggerated version of our teenage selves.
Yeah. Like Chaz could be like a real character.
And we'd adapt it to like normal times with like smartphones so kids could like get it and like think it's funny and shit.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen F is for Family?
Seen what?
F is for Family.
Oh, that's Bill Burr's show.
Bill Burr. Yeah. It's a cartoon about basically when he was a kid in the 70s. And, like, how your dad's an asshole to you all the time. And, like, it doesn't have any cell phones or anything. I don't think you need to do that. I think you literally
cartoon document the antics you guys got into in one way, shape, or form, and then you just, like you said, you exaggerate it, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I guess the problem is, like, I don't know any animators, you know?
Bear. Bear could probably do it.
Who's that? Yeah.
Shady Bear.
Oh, Shady Mare. She could design it. Like, she could probably draw out all the character models and shit.
She could draw you a character cartoon version of Bonner. Steve-O.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah, well, we would still need someone to, like, animate it and bring these characters to life and shit, you know?
Well, dude, this is never going to happen, so I'm just saying. Like,
it is going to happen, John, okay? No, don't be so, don't. Such a pessimist. Jesus Christ.
I'm a realist. It is going to happen. I'm a realist.
Well, that's what I'm trying to entertain here is, like, how probable is it that we can get in touch with someone who is in the animation industry sector of entertainment. And
right. Well, look, Nate, I'm a betting man, and I give this less than a 1% chance of ever coming to fruition.
Okay.
I would bet that I die by a shark attack more than this happened.
Okay.
That, now, there's a guy I went to high school with who works for Pixar and those types of companies. Yeah, he's a senior animator with these companies. I'm sure I could give him an email and be like, hey, dude, here's our concept.
Yeah.
Six shit-kicking kids causing trouble around a suburban town. What do you think?
Yeah, or like, why hasn't there been any, like, adult movies made with the Pixar technology? That's what I want to know.
What about iRobot?
We could break the mold with that.
What about the hot dog party or sausage party?
Sausage party.
I didn't see that one. No.
That was, again, they say things you can't say because they're hot dogs. And they're, like, the movie is raunchy.
Yeah, it looks kind of gross.
Did you guys see the Seth Rogen movie where he, like, meets his ancestor who's, like, a pickler?
Oh, I heard about that one. I haven't seen it, but I heard about it.
Watch it. You won't regret it. It's a good movie. Yeah, really good movie.
I love Seth Rogen. Love Seth Rogen, dude.
He'll be on the show one day. The Bonner Hour.
Mm-hmm.
DutchCast. On air.
Where are you guys right now? Where are you guys? What's your 20 right now?
Oh, Tennessee. We're on Bristol, Tennessee right now. We got 14 hours and 47 minutes to go. Why don't we do a little actual show here and talk to our guest? Bonner, do you have any questions for John?
I do have a question for John. What is it you do exactly?
That's a good one. What would you say you do here? That's a good question. I'm a people person. Sometimes I deliver it myself. Sometimes my secretary does it. Technology companies hire me and my partners and my firm to headhunt and conduct a search for replacement or open executive positions. So an analogy would be, I'm the general manager of the Boston Red Sox, and Xander Bogaerts has signed with the Padres. We have a gaping hole at shortstop. This isn't the way it works in the majors, but just bear with me for a minute. It would be the Red Sox hiring me and saying, Blaze, can you please give us a rundown of the top 30 shortstops in the league, as well as those who are up and coming from minor leagues, as well as the value of their contracts. And basically, we provide them with information that allows us to make informed hiring decisions that, you know, frankly, these people, yes, are paid millions and millions of dollars, but their jobs have, we're, another way to put this is we are risk mitigators.
Or like a top shelf hiring liaison.
Correct. Yeah. Top shelf hiring liaison. The way you talk about it with me a lot is you have just as much of an understanding and skill set when it comes to the positions themselves, the contracts value of themselves in that space and time with that company, with that company's life cycle. You understand the position just as well as you understand the person. It's pattern matching. So what you're looking for, when you reach the levels of the people I recruit for, they're all fucking good, right? Like, if you're a CFO, like, you're fucking good. Mm-hmm. Now, my job is less about saying, can you find 10 CFOs for us to meet? It's as much to Peter's point about understanding the company and what we call the mandate versus the job. Mm-hmm. Job is sort of what's your title and set of responsibilities. Yeah. But your mandate is what are you hired there to do, right? And so some people are really good at hyper growth. Some people are really good during bear markets, like right now. Some people are more operationally efficient. Some people are more go-to-market efficient. So, nobody has it all, rarely, right? But, the pattern matching is to say, okay, here is Miss CFO A. She's brought three companies public, but she has never worked at a company that's greater than 20,000 employees. You're trying to reach 25,000.
Mm-hmm.
This CFO candidate, and I don't want to get too, this is boring shit, so forgive me, but
with you,
it's the same thing going back to the baseball analogy. We have a gaping hole at shortstop now, but we also have a gaping hole in terms of doubles, RBIs, and runs. So just like Moneyball, how do you manufacture those again? We're not going to find a perfect replacement for Xander. Therefore, maybe we over-rotate on a highly defensive skilled shortstop, but we need to fill in those RBIs, runs, doubles that he produces.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the types of discussions that I have with my clients, which is, where are we going? How are we going to build the team that delivers on the goals you've promised to Wall Street, the goals you've promised to your investors, the goals you've promised to your employees, and the goals you promised to your customers? And that's our job, is to think about, because, so are your clients the companies or the individuals? The companies. The companies hire us, and the individuals are my people. And I like to say I'm not a headhunter. I'm not a hunter-gatherer. I'm a gardener. So I garden talent.
Yeah, you're helping to scale the business, like the company. You're helping to scale it by offering a better faculty initiative.
That's right. Well, different people are good at different stages of growth, right? Like, so the CEO that gets you from $5 million in annual revenue to 25 is not the same CEO that gets you from $50 million to $500 million. It's a different job. It's a different mandate. And so what my job a lot is moving these chess pieces around, making rich people richer and taking a small percentage of it.
Yeah.
And, mm-hmm. is it a passion? Not really. I'm really good at it.
It's more of a skill than a passion, you're saying? It's more of a skill.
That's right. My passions lie much more in the non-business world. Let's talk about, that's a good segue. Let's talk about passion for a minute. Sure. Are you passionate about playing the guitar? Or has it been a skill developed that requires putting your ass in the chair a little bit? Or both.
Well, yeah, the guitar has definitely been a passion.
Yeah.
From the get-go. But because I followed through with that passion and put in the long hours to learn the instrument, it's now become a skill. So that's usually isn't it?
And that's, I think that.
But, and let me give you the converse, though. Let me give you the converse now.
Yes.
When I moved to Tennessee, I had to get a job. because I was living in Drew's parents' house, and they're like, just get yourself a job and we'll be cool. And I had, you know, $6,000 saved, and I was fine. I didn't really need a job for a few months, however long that would last me. So I kind of jokingly started applying to window cleaning because I loved the song by Van Morrison at the time. And it was kind of just like a joke. Like, I wonder if I can get a fucking window cleaning job. Let's fucking see what Van was talking about. That's and then right. I go, and then I got into it.
It wasn't
and
wrong.
That's when I learned a skill that later became a passion. So that's the opposite.
Well, those are two good examples, and I think it's good. You happy?
Oh, yeah. I'm not happy right now. I'm not working as much as I want to be because it's cold, but I don't want to be out there either at the same time. So
I struggle with it, as you probably can tell, in that I'm interested in a lot of different things.
Yeah.
And I was kind of raised, or we were all kind of raised, in that someone that was well-rounded was a good person. And I also think you're not a flash in the pan shiny object syndrome. Ooh, I want to do that. Ooh. You're intellectually curious.
Yeah.
So, you know, things that, you know, whether it's film or whatever, you know, you're gonna like geek out on it. So yeah, it's hard. So, you know, I think the beauty of the guitar. And I'm going to say the guitar, more specifically the music for you, Bonner, is it's a very specific passion that you apply a lot of your life to, right? And I think that not many people have that. I think that what's interesting about cleaning windows is the passion isn't the cleaning of the windows, it's the simplicity of the activity and the satisfaction of the simplicity of the completion of that activity, right?
Yeah.
And my passion in my line of work is not working with venture capital firms and C-suite executives and making a shit ton of money. My passion is, as was my major in college, philosophy, is always understanding what motivates people, right? And once I know what motivates people, I can close any deal on the planet. I'm fucking good at it. But it's because I don't look at the dollars and cents. I look at what motivates this guy or gal, and let me make sure they feel like they won that part of the bargain. Right? So if you're buying a house and you're big on privacy, I'm going to sell you the hell out of the privacy in this house I found.
So not just getting them what they know or like or need because you've identified what that kind of is or what motivates.
They got to have the table stakes skills.
Yeah, of course. But not just getting them to the finish line. What you're saying is also making them believe that they're the ones that got to the finish line. And
the smartest guy in the room is the one nobody knows is making all the decisions. You know? Not to say I am, by any means. I'm usually not. But my point is that getting back to the root of the passion is that I would have left this line of work because it's very stressful and but I think that human element for me is why I enjoy it. And as you guys know, as lifelong friends, I'm very loyal with my constituency. Like Bonner, you know, you could call me and I would pick up the phone. Like if I have a friendship with you in my life, it's people know it's real. So in the business context, it helps me make the money I need to make in an industry I frankly don't care about, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know if that answered your question.
No, certainly did, man. Certainly did. Another question that I wanted to run your way. Are you in touch with any old homies? Like, who was I talking about the other day? Brian Camuso. Do you still talk to Moose?
Legend of the Hidden Temple. So, look, my OG crew, I remain very close with.
It's good.
Mainly, you know, my core St. John's friends. Mike Cassetta, Nick DeSantis was mentioned.
Yeah.
Tony Guido, Zach Dumas.
Yeah.
Paul Stankis. Is
Zach Dumas spawner?
Oh, do I remember him? Oh my god.
How would you remember him?
I remembered him. It was the first time I did snuff ever. We're all in the basement doing snuff, dude.
Like Montana snuff that I got. Oh, that's right.
Yeah, like Copenhagen snuff, dude. Yeah, like the dude. Real shit.
Yeah, dude. That was my good buddy Colin from Montana. So that crew, Moose, you know, I do keep in touch with him. He went off the radar for a while, and I think it was very intentional for him. He now has two kids. He lives Douglas, I want to say, in that area, Charles Douglas, that area. He's still working at Crusader Auto Body, the purple and white on 146. A dumpy Volvo body shop that his father, Jidge Caruso, started years ago. But he's good there. He's good. Like, I think he, you know, he's in a good place now, and I don't think he always was, and I'll leave it at that. But I don't see him as much as I'd like. He was, as Peter knows, pretty much spent every day with him when I was a kid from, like, 8 to 18 kind of thing. Yeah. And then he went to Tufts, I went to BC, and, you know, we certainly stayed in touch through college, but then things, you know, it's interesting. I mean, you know, and that's my view on friendship is, like, there's certain friends that they'll always be an active part of your lives, you know, like you guys are. But then there's some that, you know, you may lose touch with, but you shouldn't. You know, if Brian needs something, I'm there, but, like, it's just not an active part of my life. Mm-hmm. But he's still a part of my friend. You know, I care a lot about him and how things are going. And, you know, he was a member of our family growing up, you know. He was at, you know, Merrick Kever, parents to him. So, but no, Moose, I think, has a – everyone that knows Moose knows he has a unique view on the world and a unique soul.
Yep.
He doesn't fit in. He doesn't fit in amongst us. Even amongst us strange folks in the real world, he is strange within us.
Yeah, an outcast among outcasts.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
Which, you know,
Well, it's good. I'm glad to hear he's doing well. I always liked Bri, dude. It's a good shit.
He's a good-hearted man, and yeah, I think he's been a great dad. But his brother Chris, who I'm also good friends with, you know, has been struggling through cancer for years now, really bad on a few occasions, you know, so everybody's got, you know, as the great Ethan Hawke, I believe, said in Training Day, life is simply smiles and cries. Smiles and cries.
Yeah.
That's when he was smoking PCP, of course, but you know, hey, we'll give him the quote.
Dude, I love the fucking joke that the older guy says about the snail.
What does he say?
He talks about the snail shedding its shell and like having to, or it gets like kicked off the porch and has to travel all the way back to the porch, and like a year later he finds the snail again on the porch and he's like, "There's fucking snail here, man." And he looks down at the snail and he says, "What the fuck is your problem?" That's the joke. That's the joke.
That's right.
And he's like, if you can get that joke, you'll understand the streets, man.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
The fuck's your problem?
I you know, Training Day is a great movie, but I feel that there's some actors.
Oh, I just want to kick Denzel's ass the whole time, dude.
I know.
Such a shady motherfucker, but that's why he's so good, man. He's one of my favorites, man. Oh, this light just went out. Let me put this.
Yeah, he blacked out on us.
Well,
what's happening?
My light. I have this fairly professional light that doesn't have a good battery on it. So
sounds unprofessional.
It's wicked unprofessional. Yep.
went to see Avatar, Bob. Yeah, we did.
Yeah, how was it?
It's very, very impressive, the whole production. And then the storyline is fine. It's moved more into a family dynamic and family conditions versus like Hiro. And there's a couple things like
maybe Shiku's in it.
Yeah, there's this one boy dude that like lives with the avatars. I don't know how
well he got left behind.
Yeah. What was the last time you saw the first Avatar?
About a year ago, we watched it.
Okay. So you know, but after the fighting happens, and they basically send all the humans back to Earth, right?
They defend their land, right. Like Ukraine.
But they couldn't send a kid back because the kid can't go into what I think is the sleep, right?
The cryo chambers
if you're traveling long distance in outer space. So he stays. And he's like this. He's like this mini Tarzan. He's like,
he wears a loincloth.
He's like Mimi Situ from Jungle to Jungle. John and I are laughing watching Mimi
Situ. At a puppet. At a fucking pet tarantula. My read, Bonner, was lots of layers. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I've been like waiting for a legitimate movie to go see at the movies. Like, there's never any good films that come out lately. We just watched that movie Amsterdam with Christian Bale, Margot Robbie. That shit was good. That was really good.
That's with Denzel's son, right?
Is that his son?
That's his son.
Oh man, I didn't know that. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Yeah, he's good. He's really good in it.
Yeah. Murder plot.
Yeah, a little bit of that, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Fucking little relationship drama, affairs going on, people getting their eyes sliced open and fucking.
Whoa. Whoa.
Yeah, man. It's pretty intense.
Well, Bonner, you gotta watch Avatar at the theater. That's where you need to watch it.
Yeah, the visual effects and the audio effects are tremendous. Mm-hmm. The spatial effects are tremendous.
Nice.
I think that James Cameron does a great job. I think some of it's corny, some of it's incredibly insightful and like deep, some of it's just fucking cool visuals.
Yeah.
But I think it's worth the price of admission. I think they layer in a lot of things very seamlessly, which was impressive. It's a well-done movie. Mm. And I think to your point, like, I used to love every Christmas when there was, like, that blockbuster movie that we'd all go see as like a family or back in Shrewsbury or whatever. Like, even when the new Star Wars were coming out, I was excited to go. Like, Kevin and I would go, Pete and I, or whatever. Like, where the fuck are those movies this year? Or do they even make them? Top Gun Maverick, I thought was one of the fucking best movies of all time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, honestly, and I'm not a Tom Cruise guy at all.
Yeah, I have still yet to watch that one, but
that's another one that you should watch in the theater too.
Yeah. Now, that's what theaters, in my opinion, need to do is create, like, you know, four-dimensional, et cetera, experiences or just, like, super experiences. It's not really about the content as much if you can get it at home. I mean, it is and it isn't, but, like, I want to go sit in a leather recliner like we did, you know, have a couple edibles and fucking rock out.
Subwoofers underneath the seats.
Nice.
Well, hey, Bonner, it's getting late. We appreciate the time.
Any other questions for Jon Blaze?
Yes. What is your favorite late night munchie snack?
No, not including nitrous balloons after a show?
That's a great answer if you want to stay with it.
No, I mean, it's a great late night munchie. I'd say I'm going to go with street cheese. I think it's always been drumstick. Well, that's a more aspect. Like
string cheese, like the peelable string cheese.
Yeah.
Ah, nice, dude. Yeah.
Like obviously, I would go with like you know a pile of a chicken lo mein. But if I'm talking, what am I going to go to the fridge for? I'm going to go for the string cheese and in a soda. I got a Coca-Cola, dude, is to me a treat.
Ginger ale. Ginger ale is delicious too.
Pour over some ice.
Yeah.
How about you, Bonner? How about you?
Late night snack is all about nachos, man.
Oh, nice.
If you got some shredded cheese in the fridge and some chips in a bag,
yep.
You'll be all right. You'll be all right.
Well, you can start there. Late night snack for me, bowl of Golden Grahams. Ooh, nice. I get Golden Grahams.
Cereal is awesome. Yeah, cereal is awesome.
Golden Grahams, nice pick too. Yeah, because it's got that. It's just light yet tasty and yet cooling, light, cooling, and tasty. I'm a Golden Crisp guy.
I remember Cookie Crisp. I don't know if I remember Golden Crisp.
Golden Crisp is the same as Smacks. It's the same cereal. It's Rice Puffs.
Jon Edwards, pleasure to have you, my friend.
Thanks for having me. We'll see ya.
Peter, my co-anchor. Until next time.
All right, later, brother.
Cheers, man. All right, see ya.